Laplace transform possesses different properties. We are going to see those properties in this module. The first property that we are going to discuss is the property of linearity. The linearity property says that, let's say if I am having two signals, say x1 of s, say for example x1 of t, so one signal, let it be x1 of t, whose Laplace transform, let it be capital x1 of s, with a region of convergence, let's say r. What is r means? R is the region of convergence or the set of values of sigma for which this x1 of t converges. And let's suppose if we have another signal, say x2 of t, whose Laplace transform is say x2 of s with a region of convergence as say r2. So for example, this x1 of t, let it be one signal whose Laplace transform is x1 of s, and ROC be r1, and let x2 of t be another signal whose Laplace transform is x2 of s with region of convergence, let it be r2. Then the linearity property says that a linear combination of this signal x1 of t and x2 of t, so let a and b be some constants. So a linear combination would give you a similar linear combination of the Laplace transforms a x1 of s plus b x2 of s. Now what it means is, if I have a linear combination of input, I am going to have linear combination of the Laplace transforms. So that is what is called as the property of linearity. What about the region of convergence? The region of convergence of this linear combination is going to be R1 intersection R2. What it means is, it is going to be a common region that makes an overlap between R1 and R2. That is called as the linearity property, and it could be higher than this also. What it means is, a linear combination at the input will give you linear combination at the output. That means the Laplace transform is going to be a linear combination, and the region of convergence is going to be at least this region of convergence intersection. That means it is going to be at least an intersection between R1 and R2. So that's a property of linearity. So let me emphasize this. So this is the property of linearity. So this is at least. That means it could be greater than this intersection as well. Next property that we're going to see is the property of time shifting. This time shift property says that, let's say if I have a signal, say x of t, whose Laplace transform is say x of s, with a region of convergence ROC, let it be R. Then a shifted version of the input, let it be x of t minus t naught, where this small t naught is the amount of shift in the input signal. Then the Laplace transform is going to be same x of s, but with a scaling factor of e power minus s t naught, where this t naught is the amount of shift of the input signal. And the region of convergence would remain the same. ROC is going to be the same. Now that is what is called as the time shift property of the Laplace transform. This time shift property simply says that if I'm having a signal whose Laplace transform transform is XFS, then a shifted version of the input is going to give you the same Laplace transform being scaled by a factor of e power minus st naught, and the region of convergence is going to be the same. That means shifting of a signal is not going to modify the region of convergence. Next property. As we have the shift in time, we do have the similar property in the S domain as well. So the third property that we are going to see is the shift in S domain. Shift in S domain. This property says that if I am having a signal, say x of t, whose Laplace transform is say x of s with a region of convergence as say r, then the shift in s domain, so now I'm shifting in the transform domain by a factor of say s naught, then the equivalent time domain signal is going to be again x of t, but a scaled version of it, and the scaling factor is going to be e power s naught t, where this s naught is the amount of shift in the s domain. Now as we are shifting the signal in the s domain, the region of convergence is also going to be shifted. So the region of convergence, so let me write what is going to be the region of convergence. So region of convergence here, ROC, is going to be shifted version of this signal. So shifted version, so let me write that, it is going to be R, and this shift plus this sigma naught. What is this sigma naught? It is the real part of this S naught. So let me write that, this is the real part of S naught. What is S naught? S naught is the amount of shift. So if I shift in S domain, the signal is going to be scaled by a factor of e power S naught t, which is S naught is the amount of shift in S domain, and the region of convergence is going to be shifted by a factor of the real part of the shift in S domain. So this property is called as the shift in called as shift in S domain property. So let me emphasize this as well. Next property. The fourth property that we're going to see is the property of time scaling. This property says that if I am having a signal x of t whose Laplace is capital X of s with a region of convergence, let it be R, then if say for example if I shift this signal by an amount of a, sorry, if I scale the signal by an amount of a, where a is the scaling factor by which I am scaling the signal. So if you can see that this is the time scaling that I'm doing here. If I time scale this signal, then the Laplace transform is going to be the scaled version of the Laplace transform of the original signal. So it is going to be capital X of S by A times, there's a change in the magnitude as well, mod A, where the region of convergence ROC is also going to be a scaled version of the original region of convergence. It is going to be A times R. So this is the property of time scaling. As you can see from this property that if I'm having a signal whose Laplace transform is capital X of S with the region scale version of the input signal will give you the scale version of the Laplace transform, and also the region of convergence is going to be scaled by the factor of same scaling factor, that is A here. That is a property of time scaling. Next property. So let's look at the fifth property. The fifth property is the property of differentiation in time. So this is called as differentiation in time. This property says that, let's say if I'm having a signal, say x of t, whose Laplace is say x of s, with the region of convergence ROC being let's say R, then let's say if I differentiate the input signal, that means if I take dxt of dt, then the Laplace transform is going to be s times x of s plus this x of 0, small x of 0. I'll explain this. This property is called as the differentiation in time property, which says that if I simply take the differentiation in time domain, we are going to get the Laplace transform that is going to be multiplied by a factor of s. And this is going to be minus sign here. This minus of small x of 0. This small x of 0 is nothing but what is called as the initial condition or the initial value of this original signal. That means that t equals to 0. Now the region of convergence, what is going to be the region of convergence? The region of convergence is going to be, let me note that, the region of convergence ROC is going to be at least R. That means that if not more, it is going to be at least the region of convergence of that of the original signal. Let me emphasize this property. This property is called as the differentiation property. Now, what do you mean by this at least? Because this term has come in previous properties as well. So let's take an example. For example, if I'm taking a signal, say, for example, if I'm taking x of t as u of t, that means simply a unit step signal, then the Laplace transform x of s is going to be 1 upon s. However, if I take the differentiation of the input, that means say x of t, if I'm taking it as del of t is equals to del of t, that is the differentiation version of this u of t, then the Laplace transform x of s is going to be 1. Now I didn't mention the region of convergences here. The region of convergences for the original signal was sigma greater than 0, and for the new signal, the differentiated signal, it would be an entire s plane. So this example demonstrates that if I'm having a signal whose Laplace is 1 upon s and is having some region of convergence, say sigma greater than 0. Now if I take the differentiation of the input signal, so differentiation of u of t is del of t, then the Laplace transform is going to be 1. is going to be at least r, that means it is going to be at least sigma greater than 0, but here it is going to be an entire S plane. So that's the meaning of at least this region of convergence, that is r. This property is called as the differentiation property, differentiation in time property of Laplace transform. Now, as we have the differentiation property, we do have the property of integration. Let me write that. So this property is called as the integration in time property. Integration in time this property is called as integration in time property, and this property says that, let's say if I'm having a signal, say, now let me write that, if I'm having a signal x of t, whose Laplace transform is, say, x of s with a region of convergence ROC, let it be R, then the Laplace transform of integration of the signal, so I'm taking the integration of the input x of t, where this integration is all the way from minus infinity to t dt. So I'll take different variables here because this is going to be temporary variable. Then the Laplace transform is going to be somewhat inverted, or simply the inverse of what we have in the differentiation property. So it is going to be equals to x of s by s plus 1 upon s integration from minus infinite to 0 x of tau d tau. Now that's the property of integration. Now let me write that and explain once I'm done with this. So the region of convergence and this, the ROC or the region of convergence is going to be, what is the region of convergence of the original signal? The original signal, if it is having the region of convergence of, let's say, R, then it is going to be at least. So it is going to be at least an intersection of R and this sigma greater than 0. So what this means is, let me emphasize this property. This property is called as the integration property, the integration in time property of the Laplace transform. Now let's try to, I'm not going to prove this. This is very easy to prove. You just have to take the integration in the original formula of Laplace transform and you would get this expression. But let me explain what this means. If an original signal x of t is having a Laplace transform x of s with some region of convergence, say R, then if we take an integration in the time domain, it is going to be x of s upon s plus 1 upon s, and this factor here, because of this initial condition, as we have the similar factor in the differentiation. Now you may see a close relationship between the differentiation and the integration property. If we differentiate the signal, we are going to have this, the multiplication of s in the Laplace domain, and if we integrate, we are going to have this division of s in the Laplace domain. And there is going to be an additional factor, what is called as an initial condition, that is x naught here, and we are going to have this similar kind of initial condition factor here as well in the integration property. Now this region of convergence, what it means is, if the original region of convergence is R, then the region of convergence of the integrated signal is going to be at least the intersection of that original signal, region of convergence, and sigma greater than 0. What it means is, this property is holds true for the signals that are right hand sided, that means that are 0 for t less than 0. For example, u of t is the right hand sided signal, so the region of convergence there is sigma greater than 0. So those kind of signals are having the region of convergence that is having sigma greater than 0. So if we integrate a signal, then the resultant region of convergence is going to be the intersection of sigma greater than 0 and the original region of convergence. That's what is the meaning of this overlapping. Next property. And most important property is time convolution property. So the seventh property is time convolution property. This property says that if I'm having a signal, say x1 of t, whose Laplace is say x1 of s, with a region of convergence ROC, let it be R1, and let's say if I'm having another signal, say x2 of t, whose region of convergence and Laplace transform is x2 of s, and the ROC as R2, then if we convolve two signals x1 of t and x2 of t in time domain, then in Laplace domain, it is going to be the multiplication of their individual Laplace transforms. And the region of convergence, ROC, is going to be at least, so here also the region of convergence is going to be at least the region of convergence of the individual Laplace transforms. So let me write that, it is going to be at least R1. R1 intersection with R2, so it is going to be at least the overlapping of R1 and R2. So that is the property of time convolution. It simply says that if I convolve in time, it is going to be multiplication in the Laplace domain, with the region of convergence being the overlapping portion between R1 and R2. Now that's the property of time convolution. Next, we are going to see the called as some properties, or you can say that they are theorems. So the eighth is what is called as some theorems. So they are called as initial and final value theorems. Initial and final value theorems. Now these theorems provides some flexibility or some kind of benefit of operating in the Laplace domain. So let me write that and then I will explain. So this initial and final value theorem says that if the signal x of t such that if x of t is such that x of t is 0 for t less than 0, that means there is nothing before t equals to 0, that means if a signal is 0 towards left, then so this is the constraint that a signal must satisfy in order to go for this initial and final value theorem. If a signal is right hand sided, that means it is 0 for t less than 0. If it is that kind of signal, not only right hand sided, it can be a short duration signal as well. So if a signal is 0 for t less than 0, that means for negative values of t, then we can easily find the initial or the final value of this original signal x of t in the Laplace domain. What it means is x of t for t going to 0, or I'll say that x of 0 is going to be equals to limit s tends to infinite s of x of s. This is called as the initial value theorem. It means that if I want to find the initial value or the zeroth value of the signal x of t, then you can find that easily in the Laplace domain x of s. You simply have to multiply that with s and take the limits of s tending towards infinite, and that will give you exactly the initial value of x of t. Now similarly, we can have what is called as the final value of x of t. So x of t for this t limit t tending to infinite, that means x of infinite. So what is going to be the final value of x of t? It is going to be equals to limit s tends to 0 s x of s. This is called as the final value theorem. So let me write this and emphasize. Is called as the initial and final value theorems. What it means is, if I'm having a signal x of t which satisfies such constraints, that means it must be 0 for t less than 0, then we can find the initial value and the final value of the signal in the Laplace domain directly. So what we just have to do is to multiply that with s and take suitable limits. If you have to find the initial value, you just have to multiply the Laplace transform by s and take the limits of s tending towards infinite. If I want to find the final value, that means x of infinite, what is going to be the final value of the signal, you simply multiply the Laplace transform of the original signal by s and take this s tending towards 0. Now this is true only if this x of t satisfies this constraint. We shall see more into the Laplace transform in the next module. See you then.